Our subject this week is Vaetchanan, the idea that changed the world. And what was that idea? Well, let's turn to some really extraordinary words spoken by Moses in this week's parasha. He tells the Israelites, Ushmatem vasitem, you shall be very careful to fulfill the chukim u'mishpatim, the laws that I've mentioned to you, ki hi chochmatchem uvinatchem le'eneo amim, because that is your wisdom and understanding in the eyes of the nations, who will hear about these decrees and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. Now, listen to this for a moment. It's an extraordinary remark. Moses is saying, non-Jews will see the wisdom of the Torah. He is even implying that non-Jews may sometimes see the wisdom of the Torah more clearly than Jews. And it will be the fact that non-Jews respect it that may even lead Jews to respect it. And that's really extraordinary. I mean, think about when this was said and how it was said. Here is a moment in history when the Israelites have just been slaves. They still don't even have their own land. They have no influence on anyone. They have no power whatsoever. And yet 3,300 years ago, Moses is saying, one day your story, your laws, your Torah will inspire the world. And that is really rather remarkable. And I want us to witness how this actually happened. We're going to watch a couple of little moments, a few moments from history, and I want you to listen very carefully to the language you're about to hear.
For I have sworn before you and Almighty God the same solemn oath our forebears prescribed nearly a century and three quarters ago. The world is very different now, for man holds in his mortal hands the power to abolish all forms of human poverty and all forms of human life. And yet the same revolutionary beliefs for which our forebears fought are still at issue around the globe. The belief that the rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God.
Our destiny in the midst of change will rest on the unchanged character of our people and on their faith. They came here, the exile and the stranger, brave but frightened, to find a place where a man could be his own man. They made a covenant with this land, conceived in justice, written in liberty, bound in unions.
With hope and virtue, let us brave once more the icy currents and endure what storms may come. Let it be said by our children's children that when we were tested, we refused to let this journey end, that we did not turn back, nor did we falter. And with eyes fixed on the horizon and God's grace upon us, we carried forth that great gift of freedom and delivered it safely to future generations. Thank you. God bless you.
Now, the language that you just heard is unique in politics. There is John F. Kennedy, 1961. The rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God. Lyndon Baines Johnson, 1965. They made a covenant with this land, conceived in justice, written in liberty, bound in union. It was meant one day to inspire the hopes of all mankind. Barack Obama, 2009. With eyes fixed on the horizon and God's grace upon us, we carried forth that great gift of freedom and delivered it safely to future generations. This is the language of Sefer Devarim. Without the Book of Devarim, such language would not exist. It presupposes, number one, that we, the people, are bound in covenant with God. Number two, that covenant is essentially moral, conceived in justice, written in liberty. And number three, we need the grace of God to succeed, and we need to hand it on to future generations. That is essentially the thesis of Sefer Devarim. This is covenant language. It is an extended midrash on the Book of Devarim, and you will find something similar in almost every single inaugural address of an American president since the first one in 1789 by George Washington. How did this happen? And the answer is, it happened as a result of a whole sequence of historical events. The first one was the invention of printing by Johannes Gutenberg in the mid-15th century, the invention of the printing press, and in England by William Caxton, and here is Caxton showing off his new invention. And the invention of printing, of course, meant the spread of literacy to millions of people throughout Europe, and for the first time they could afford to have books. Second event, in 1517, the Reformation, Luther, Calvin, and its enormous emphasis on the authority of the individual as opposed to the church or the king or the state. And number two, the principle of sola scriptura. If you want to know what God wants from us, you have to read the Bible. Those were the key things from the Reformation. Then came the first translations of the Bible into the vernacular, the first translations of the Bible into English, for instance. The Bible was, in fact, as we'll see in a moment, a surprisingly subversive book, because in Tanakh, what do we find? We find prophets unafraid to criticize kings. We find Shaul HaMelech, King Saul, losing his kingship because he fails to fulfill the word of God. And therefore, people, rulers, didn't want people to be able to read the Bible. So they made sure the Bible was only in a language that only the most learned could possibly understand, either in Greek or in Latin. And therefore, to publish the Bible in an English translation was illegal in the 16th century. William Tyndale produced a translation of the Bible in English. The end result was Tyndale tried, found guilty, and burned at the stake. However, what happened was, and this is happening today in countries like Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Syria, however hard you are a repressive ruler, it's very hard to defeat new media of communication. And so Bibles continued to be printed, especially in Geneva, where a whole number of Christian scholars, Calvinists and the like, went, because Geneva was the home of Calvin. And there they produced something called the Geneva Bible in 1560, which got smuggled in huge numbers to England. And the Geneva Bible was read, amongst others, by Shakespeare, by Cromwell, by Milton, by John Donne, and of course, the early settlers of America. Now, if you actually look at the Geneva Bible, you can probably see that round the edges are a commentary. Okay, it's a little commentary in Jewish terms, but it's a commentary. And there are few sentences in the Geneva Bible that are absolutely explosive. First chapter of Sefer Shemot. What happens? We have in Shemot, Pharaoh tells the midwives Shifra and Puah, kill every male Israelite child. And what happens is Shifra and Puah don't do it. And Shifra and Puah are the first recorded instances of civil disobedience in all of history, refusing to obey an illegal order. You note what the Geneva Bible says. Their disobedience in this was lawful. They shouldn't have deceived Paro, but it was lawful. Now that is explosive. It means if a king is immoral, you can disobey the king. And here, of course, the king comes along and says, well, in that case, everyone, you see a male Israelite child, go and drown it. And you see what the commentary says in the margin, when tyrants cannot prevail by deceit, they burst into open rage. Now, that was incendiary. That's exactly what kings did not want people to read. That's why King James made the King James Bible in 1611. And you will note, if you ever see a King James Bible, it has no commentary in the margins. But there it was. The Geneva Bible got out because of etc., etc. And the result was, several decades later, the English Civil War in the 1640s and the overthrow of the king, who lost his head as a result, King Charles I, and the victory by Cromwell, who was, of course, a Puritan and essentially a Calvinist. Of course, eventually the monarchy, you know, England works by compromise, and you had the Restoration and the Grand Treaty of Rights in 1688. So this whole Jewish period, covenant period in English history, didn't last very long. However, another group had taken Tanakh with them, namely all the early settlers in America, starting with the Mayflower in 1620, and then the Arabella in 1630, and John Winthrop aboard the Arabella makes this famous speech, which is Devarim chapter 30, 31, in the original Hebrew and in English, making a covenant between the people and the new land of America. But of course, already in 1620, the people aboard the Mayflower made the Mayflower Compact, that is the Mayflower Covenant. So America was born in covenant. It was born by people who, because of printing, because of the Reformation, because of Tyndale, because of the Geneva Bible, all knew Tanakh, and they knew that when you want to create a just, fair, decent society, you have to make a brit with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you might have to make a covenant with God, and that is what they did. And that is why it had an impact in England until 1688, but then not much more. But in America, that culture, based on Sefer Devarim, lasted all the way from that day to this. And the end result was America is a society on whose founding document is Sefer Devarim. Incidentally, there's something very interesting here, because the modern world is made by four different revolutions. The English Revolution, the American, the French in 1789, and the Russian Revolution in 1917. And it is almost as if we have in front of us a controlled experiment in what creates a free society. In England and America, the revolutions were both based on Tanakh, on Torah, specifically on Sefer Devarim. In Russia and France, the revolutions were based on philosophers. The French Revolution based on Jean-Jacques Rousseau, and the Russian Revolution based on Karl Marx. Well, I think you probably know the story that the French Revolution ended in years of revolutionary terror, the Reign of Terror between 1793 and 1794, and Russia landed up under Lenin and then much more so under Stalin as the most repressive regime in the Northern Hemisphere in the 20th century. So, in other words, you want a free society, make sure your rebellion is based on terror. But now we come to the irony of all ironies, which is that in America, they really understood you want a free society, you base it on Torah, you base it on Sefer Devarim. Here, for instance, is the second president of the United States, John Adams, who comes between George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, and he writes to a friend, "I will insist that the Hebrews have done more to civilize men than any other nation. If I were an atheist and believed in blind eternal fate, I should still believe that fate had ordained the Jews to be the most essential instrument for civilizing the nations." John Adams, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, all the way through to John F. Kennedy, Lyndon Baines Johnson, Barack Obama, and all the presidents in between, understand. And now you see the extraordinary prophecy. 3,300 years ago, Moshe Rabbeinu said, keep this Torah carefully, because This is your wisdom and understanding in the eyes of the nations. Do you know what? It was the wisdom and understanding in the eyes of the nations. This particular Torah became the basis for the American Revolution and remains so today, America, the world's single remaining superpower. Where is one place where the culture politically is not based on Torah? Sadly, ironically, the State of Israel. The State of Israel is built on a series of great ideas, high ideals. The early Zionists were inspired by Karl Marx, by Leo Tolstoy, by Friedrich Nietzsche. Religious Zionists accepted. The only person they weren't inspired by was Moshe Rabbeinu in his Torah. And so we have the irony that Moses already foresaw that one day the nations would understand the value of Torah in creating a society better even than Jews did. Frankly, that's not how it ought to be. And so we owe a great debt of thanks to the late Professor Daniel Elazar, who revived this whole study of Jewish political theory and how it might apply to the State of Israel, and that is done by scholars today in various bits of Israel, most especially, I think, in the Shalem Center in Jerusalem, where they're taking this Torah and turning it into a political philosophy that will make Israel, I think, stronger as a society. But Moshe Rabbeinu already saw this. And I think we have to go back and hear his words again. Observe them carefully, for this is your wisdom and understanding in the eyes of the nations. The whole political vision of Sefer Devarim, a vision of social justice, of compassion, of human dignity, and love of the stranger, is as relevant today as the time when Moses first gave voice to it. Let us too be inspired by it. Shabbat Shalom.